Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
I'm going to ask Mr. Lashley if he will give our invocation, please.
Let us bow our heads and pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for all the many blessings you have showered on us this week and this day. But we just ask you to be with the people in harm's way around the world who represent the United States and just protect them, put your hand of protection around them and bring them back home safe. And give us the information that we need to make the decisions that's important to the county. And we ask all this in your holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, start with the public comments now, and Eddie Sheep.
Good evening, Madam Chairman.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Material that I gave you in those packets is basically the same stuff I've been telling you, except that's the raw data. I encourage you to get Mr. Walker to verify it. I think you'll find that Alamance County is fixing to give away the farm. My figures show that if we were to use the statute line, Alamance would gain 1,200 acres, all of it, I mean, in the south and the east, and only lose 400 acres in the far north of the county. All the data's there. I may be off on the math here and there. That's the reason I gave you a copy, Mr. Walker. And I don't say I'm happy with Mebane's plan. I can live with it. I just don't know if Alamance County can live with losing this much, losing all this land. Okay. And so that's basically all I got to say. I hope you'll study it. And you can't come back and say you didn't know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Karen Wilkinson, please say your name.
Yes, good evening, Commissioners. I'm Dr. Karen Wilkinson. I practice private practice, but in addition to my private practice, I am also a workplace wellness consultant. What I want to do this evening is talk a little bit about my thoughts on the proposed health center at Alamance Regional for the employees. Okay. I'm going to give some statistics here briefly. They're national statistics. I think Alamance County will parallel those statistics. I have tried to get a little bit of information ahead of time to help me out a little bit better, to give you guys a little bit better information, but I've not been able to do that, and that's okay. Nationally, healthcare expenditures have doubled between 1990 and 2001 and are set to double again by 2012. Okay. Statistically, chronic illnesses are crippling our employers. 47% of our country is chronically ill. Okay, with that chronically illness, that's costing us trillions and trillions of dollars every year, in addition to 79% lost productivity in workers. So those are astronomical numbers. 4 out of the 10 most costly conditions are related to heart disease and stroke, costing $475 billion a year. Diabetes, alcohol, tobacco, drug use, back-related injuries, and obesity are other key problems that account for about $373 billion also nationally. Again, Alamance County probably should follow in the same kind of percentages. Statistically, though, 70% of these problems are preventable through lifestyle changes. That is huge, okay? So we should be able to do something about what we're having happen here. Unfortunately, though, most healthcare expenditures, 95% of them go to covering diagnostic and treatment. 2 to 3% of that goes to early detection, and only 1 to 2% goes to prevention. So that is a reactive approach and not a proactive approach. I am a big proponent of proactive. If we don't start preventing what we treat, we are going to be in a whole lot bigger bind than we're currently in at the moment. Remember, 70% of these things that we deal with are preventable. We just have to have some form of a proactive approach. The program that you guys are considering this evening, in my opinion, is a reactive approach. If you're waiting until somebody gets sick, you're reacting to their sickness. You're not trying to prevent the sickness. So proactive is definitely the way to be and is going to have your most impact on your money. We have to begin preventing what we treat, or we're going to be in trouble. okay? Approximately, and this is what I got from the budget, and tell me if I'm wrong, Alamance County is spending about $8 million on health care expenses. That's about $8,000 per employee. That is double the national average, and our national average is extremely high. Is that my ding-ding? Time to be quiet. One more thing.
Okay.
So, again, proactive approach. I deal with a lot of these things with wellness consulting. I would love to be able to give some guidance on that. Mr. Honeycutt, I sent some information to him today. I'd love to be able to do some form of proactive wellness program, give the insurance committee some kind of insight on maybe the directions to go for the county. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Well, thank you.
Good information.
Henry Vines. And I forget to remind it's 3 minutes in.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Henry Vines. I'm from Snow Camp. Thank you all for giving me the opportunity to speak this afternoon. First of all, I'd like to invite each and every one of you and all the citizens here to the Alamance Cattlemen's Association's annual Earth Roast. It's this Saturday. It's $8.50 per plate. We use this money that we raise to sponsor scholarships here in the county. We give out five $1,000 scholarships each and every year to graduating seniors here. And we certainly want to extend that invitation to each and every one. If you need a ticket, I have some in my pocket.
Now, what's the location there?
It's at Southern Alamance. It will be from 4.
High school.
Yeah. From 4 to 7 o'clock, it's eat-in or take-out, whichever you would like. We have a drive-through that you can come through and pick up your plate if you don't want to stay and eat with us, but we'll have some real good desserts there from all the ladies there that prepare those. One other thing right quickly, I was looking over the proposed policy on sponsorships. I had a little bit concern on some of those things in that it's not coming back to this council for approval, and I would just appreciate as y'all deliberate on this that y'all would take that into consideration. I certainly don't have anything against the Parks and Recreation, but I do feel like that a lot of these things need to come back to the board for an approval, because that's what we got y'all up here for, to look over our business and make sure that it's conducted like it should. And I'd appreciate y'all looking at that. Thanks.
Thank you, Henry.
Okay, the next thing we have is, I don't have any more public comments. At this time, I close the public comments. Sponsorship agreement for operations of AO Elementary Fields, and Mr. Haygood.
Good evening, Commissioners. First item I have for your consideration this evening involves the county renewing a sponsorship agreement that we currently have with the Northern Alamance Athletic Club for the operations of fields at AO Elementary School. We've been involved with the Northern Alamance Athletic Club for a number of years. We renew this agreement every year. This, in fact, is the last agreement that we have in place like this at an active Alamance Burlington School System site. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. If you approve it, we will take this agreement to the club for their ratification also.
Am I getting questions?
Is this the same issue that Henry's talking about?
Yes, it is.
Can we have a little dialogue back and forth here about his concerns?
Well, this is not.
It's the next item.
That's the next item.
Yes. Okay.
That's
the next item.
Yeah, this is just about the AO school.
Okay, I didn't think it was.
No, it's Northern.
Yeah, this is all about the use of their field.
I make a move that we
accept it.
I'll second.
Okay, second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, got that. Now the next one.
Now this is
Yes. The next item that we have for your consideration, our department staff have put together a policy that you have in front of you that lists out ways that private industry here in the county could possibly become involved with the department, primarily through financial contributions to the county to make improvements at parks and rec facilities. These are for ones that are already established, like Cedar Rock Park, or for some of the newer projects that we're working on, which include our efforts along the Hall River Trail, paddle and land, the property up near Garinger on Garinger Mill Road that we're currently working to develop, and also the Sykes property out on Turner Road. So what we tried to do, we looked at some policies that are in place other parts of the state. We took a look at some of the other park properties here in Alamance County, particularly the city of Burlington, looked at the way they offer businesses or private individuals the opportunity to sponsor amenities inside of park properties. this policy that you have has been before the Parks Commission. They've reviewed it and made a recommendation that I bring it here to you tonight. It does go in here, as Mr. Vines alluded to, not every single sponsorship we're at this time recommending to bring before the board. We can do that. We do not mind doing that at all. I think we had limited it to around a $20,000 level. But we would be happy to bring any of them before you if you desire for us to do that. What we've tried to do is lay out a way that private business or individuals can know up front what they would get from us if they want to contribute funds to make improvements in park properties, that we would be willing to recognize them and their dedication to the community, but there are certain ways that we would have to do that. By having a policy like this, we can market it, we can put it out there, everyone would have an opportunity to be involved if they want to. And we've also, the Parks Commission has made a recommendation, I've talked with county manager about allowing the funds that are generated from this policy to be reverted back to the facility. So if someone, for example, sponsored a shelter at Cedar Rock Park, we would be able to take that money rather than it go just into general fund for operations. It would be designated to be put back into the Cedar Rock Park shelters. So you can see there's some dollar amounts listed in here. It lays out a lot of information about the criteria. That would be one of the concerns. This is a public program. It's a program that is offered by you through our department. So we tried to lay out some criteria for who we would be desirous to have sponsor. If anything came up that was unusual or might compromise our facility or our programs, we would come to the county manager. We would come to this body. And then again, for the larger dollar amounts, we would certainly come here. But we would be happy to bring any and all of them to your attention and to the county manager's attention as well.
Do we have any now? Do we have any sponsors now that do any of this stuff?
We have some program sponsors that help us with the football championship broadcast that's done on WBAG.
Right.
We have the Junior Fishing Rodeo. We have several. Most of this is oriented toward facilities to help us with some facility maintenance issues, particularly with some of the newer things that we're trying to do. So we would put this out for anyone's consumption and let them, you know, come to us. But we do have some right now. And I think, being as the kind of business that we're in, we're a quality of life organization. There are a lot of industry and private, even individuals here in the county who share the desire to improve residents' quality of life and are interested in being involved. I think this would provide a mechanism for them to do that uniformly, where everyone would have the same shot. They'd all know there are ways. We're also working on, we want to include this in a volunteer guide that we're putting together that lists all the ways that people or businesses can do volunteer work with our department. We get a lot of calls from people who want to know, what can I do to work with you? And we do Special Olympics, and we need youth baseball coaches and basketball coaches, and we need people to do numerous things. We'd like to be able to take our volunteer opportunities, combine them with this information here, and be able to give it to a business. We just had one local business come out to Cedar Rock Park. There was a section of trail there that needed to be rerouted due to some, you know, wash and damage,
right.
And they took that on as a project. And it just was because one of them rides horses at the park. So we thought, gosh, it'd be really nice to put that out for folks and say, if you're looking for a team-building exercise for your staff, this would be a great thing to do, and we're happy to have it, I can tell you.
So how would you recognize that if they how do you recognize that as
right
far
now for,
as advertising for
if,
them?
If someone came, if they came out to work on, like, the horse trail, since there's not really – any money involved with them, you know, giving us cash, it was like, we recognize them in our newsletters that we put out. We try to recognize them on the website and say, hey, you know, Brian Haygood Incorporated came out, did work on 2 miles of trail. We really appreciate it, particularly the newsletter. We our newsletter goes to a lot of folks.
Yeah.
And now, you know, if an industry came to us and said they wanted to, they didn't have the ability to send folks out to work, they would be willing to, you know, donate X number of dollars, then it's possible through some signage at certain locations in the park, and we could recognize them for what they've done.
But not big billboards or anything.
No, and I think that's what we wanted to make sure any interested business understood, that there are only certain ways that we really want to recognize them. And that has to be up front. If not, they may not choose to do that. They may want a billboard, which I certainly understand. We just want to be able to tell them through this instrument, we don't do that. We would do the following for you, and if that works, great. You know, we'd be happy to have you. But it does say in here that I believe it's a $20,000 level that actually comes back to you. But you can amend this policy if you so desire and make it any of them. Really, the ones that we, that's getting into a much larger dollar level, and that's when you start getting around naming things for people and stuff like that. I think it would be wise for us to before we did that, so you would get a chance to review it and approve. I think what we've tried to do, too, with the criteria that we've established in here, trying to say these are the type of programs that we offer. We want to be selective as we can, the people that sponsor it, not compromise what we do by letting, you know, somebody we may not want sponsor program. But again, we wouldn't have any problem with, even if it's not done here at this body, we can let you know, maybe perhaps by a memo, saying we've had Brian Haga has offered to sponsor a picnic table at Great Bend Park. And we can inform you of that, maybe not necessarily take board action. We can if you'd like to do it through board action. If you want to stay with the $20,000 level, that would be where I would come here and tell you about it. I can certainly, for any other level, email you, send you a written memo saying we have been approached by, you know, Brian Haga Incorporated, and they want to give $2,500 for a shelter. We think
what
this is great.
What proposal do they have to make to the Recreation Department to give the money?
What we've had happen so far,
for
the program so far that we've done, we come up with a list of ads. It's usually sponsor name tied to a media ad that could be print or radio, and it has been television, but not very much. And we make sure the sponsor sees how many ads their name will be attached to. We tell them it'll be on the website in a certain format, JPEG, this many pixels by this many. We really try to be very thorough to let them know that. How many times it will run, and we get the information that they want. If they have a certain logo or a tagline that they want said on the radio, you know, community friendliness or something like that, we make sure it's put in too. I think with this policy, we would do the same thing for any of the programmatic stuff. If you're sponsoring an event like the Farm Festival at Cedar Rock Park, we usually have a marketing campaign that we do for that event anyway to let everybody know. Sometimes it's flyers through the school, and we'll put a certain size logo on the flyer. The school system has been acceptable of that as long as it was our program and the sponsor funds were helping it happen. We would continue to do those things. And then we would have templates of signage that they would be able to view. So if they're wanting to, say, do a picnic shelter at Cedar Rock Park, for example, we would be able to present, show them, this is the size, these are the colors, your logo here, and really that would be about it. Otherwise, you could get into you know, something that we may not want out at the park.
But you would control that too.
Yes, through this instrument, and really they would know up front if they want to be a part of it or not. It's okay.
Well, do you not do that with, like, if people want to buy uniforms for kids or something? Do you do that at all, or do
no,
we pay
not,
for
not
everything?
At this time. Right now, we're buying uniforms for we have about 215 teams total in the department, complete. We buy uniforms for about 50 to 55 of those, and we've just been doing that. So this is something that's included in here is league sponsorship.
Right, that would save the county money if somebody would sponsor a team or whatever.
Sure, and what they could do is possibly choose to do an age group, perhaps. You may have a business out there that says, I would be willing to sponsor all the Pee Wee boys that play through your program. Right. You know, we would have the number and somewhere on the uniform a logo for the business. You know, it might be, I don't know, I don't want to use any corporate names, but you can imagine what I'm talking about. On the sleeve, perhaps, or on the back, every Pee-wee kid that gets a uniform from us would have that on there. But that would be told to the sponsor. Say we estimate approximately 250 of these kids on 25 teams, and your logo would be on every one of them. And again, that could be something, not through this policy, we probably normally wouldn't be bringing to you for actual approval. We could certainly, as soon as we're approached by someone and work out the particulars, we would let Mr. Honeycutt and all members of the board know in enough time. If you had an issue with that, you could come back to us and say, wait a minute, that, you know, that's not, we won't talk about that or whatever.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, the only thing in the wording there, I think, you know, it says if it's 20,000 or more, it would require the written approval of the county manager, who shall inform the board. I think if it's $20,000, I'd like to talk about it and let somebody get some credit up here, because if they're willing to contribute $20,000, I think it's worthwhile to talk about it.
So would you be interested in maybe changing
just that wording there to change it from that anything over 20,000 would come to the board.
Okay.
Will require instead of shall.
Will require the approval of the Board of Commissioners?
Commissioners.
Where would you need shelters or? I know the women's division, we put a shelter at Whitsett Park, the Chamber of Commerce Women's Division. We actually put one in Burlington at Whitsett. So
currently, we don't have any that we have on the ground now sponsored, none. And right. Particularly the ones at Cedar Rock Park get a tremendous amount of use. And so we would be offering those. They're already existing, but we need to do some repair work on them. So whatever we gather, we would, you know.
Oh, okay.
And we also are looking at the possibility of shelters at some of these paddle trail access points
right.
that we're putting along the river.
Right.
The property up near Western High School, 200 acres that we're developing,
right.
we're interested in shelters there. Those would be new. That's when you get into a little bit of the higher dollar amounts because it would be something brand new. And then we've been working closely with Roger Cobb and Cooperative Extension for that Sykes property out on Turner Road, which is almost 180 acres. Which we're working with him and a group to come up with uses. And that would be another facility where we would be. We also have the need for ball field sponsorships. We're now operating three baseball, softball complexes that we would be interested in talking with people about sponsorship levels there. And I think what we would try to do is use these funds to not have to ask for capital funding. You know, get it from somebody that gets recognition and then put it right back into the facility.
All right.
That's a good idea.
Okay.
Would you like for us to inform you and management of any sponsorship that we get? I think that might be something to address Mr. Fines.
Yeah.
Or if he wanted to comment, I'm not sure.
Yes, that. And there's one other thing that I forgot to bring up, too, that I noticed in there is the part about the discretion of the county manager and the Parks and Recreation to deny, you know, a sponsorship. What kind of liabilities or whatever is that going to place back toward the county, you know, if you deny one group and allow another group? And I mean, I don't know what the legal is, and maybe that's something applied to what would that, you know, by not having no clear set policy as, you know, we're not going to allow drugstore ads, or I mean, I'm just using that as a example.
We would try to point to an established criteria if the board approves it and say that would be across the board for everybody. We wouldn't be just picking on one specific type of business that might be interested in it that may fall under one of these. But I don't know if you would want to comment on that, Clyde. But without this currently, if I personally tell a business, no, I don't have anything that I'm pointing at that demonstrates any will of the board. So it would just be me saying, I don't think you guys need to be, you know, sponsoring a team or sponsoring.
Well, maybe that's something we need to add to it.
Yes. And it could be, if you feel more comfortable that, you know, I certainly would be fine delegating the ability to deny a sponsorship to either a consensus or actual action from the board and certainly from the county manager in conjunction with the county attorney. We would do that anyway. If someone came to me and I had a bad feeling about the business that was wanting to sponsor a team,
sure.
Or a facility.
Sure.
First thing I'm going to do is call Mr. Honeycutt and Mr. Albright and say we may have an issue here.
Okay.
You already have that criteria with coaching.
Yes, that's true. We do.
We apply the same type of criteria.
Mm-hmm. Okay. More questions?
Would you, I was looking in here, I don't have it right in front of me, but somewhere in here it does say that, you know, I can change it to where it would say, you know, a denial of sponsorship opportunity. Okay, under the sponsorship criteria, it could be made to specifically say if it's going to be denied, perhaps to make sure that the manager and the attorney, county attorney, know.
And I guess we could also give them the option if they wanted to appeal it to the Board of Commissioners.
You know, that's a good idea.
An objectionable. Somebody, let's say, want a beer or a t-ball field.
Right,
it may
right.
not be the right message or appropriate, and that's denied. And then if they wanted to appeal that, they could come from the Board of Commissioners, and it would be your final decision, but there'd be an appeal process as part of it.
Well, I think it really does state it here where it says Alamance County possesses sole and final authority for determining the appropriateness of the
what page are you on?
Sponsorship.
Page?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Under the authorization required at the top of the page here. So it really is. I mean, I'm not a lawyer, Clyde, but it sounds like we already have that authorization to the county in that.
Okay. Any more questions? You say that, Brian?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any more questions? Do I hear a motion that we accept?
So moved.
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Okay. Thank you.
Very good.
Thank you. Okay. The next thing we have is the Sherry. There you go.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I'm here tonight to give an update of the happenings of the Insurance Committee. And I guess before I get into that, let's just talk a little bit about the insurance plan. Alamance County's health insurance plan is a self-insured plan. So what that means is that each time an employee files a claim, any costs that are not the employee's responsibility is paid directly out of the Alamance County Health Insurance Fund. So what that means is we've got a relationship with WellPath, but really their responsibility is to process the claims for us. They're looking to see, was the provider in network? Were they out of network? How much has the employee met towards their deductible? And once they look at all of those things, they decide how much is the patient's responsibility? How much is the county's responsibility? Then they pay that claim, and that money comes directly out of the Alamance County's health insurance fund. So when we say that each time an employee goes to the doctor, each time they have surgery, Alamance County's directly paying for it, that's what we mean. Those funds are coming directly out of the insurance fund. So the insurance committee, what we're looking at is ways that we can control or minimize the increased cost of providing health insurance to Alamance County employees and their dependents and those retirees who have already left the county. The focus on controlling the health care costs relies on early detection and prevention of chronic health care diseases and then also easy access to health care. We have been working with Alamance Regional Medical Center, and they have provided a proposal to us that we feel addresses those two areas. The proposal includes a health care center, and it also includes some preventative screening. With the preventative screening, what we would do is each Alamance County employee would go through a health risk assessment. It's basically a paper assessment talking about their health habits, their family history, that sort of thing. And then also it's combined with blood draws that look at their lipid panels, cholesterol screening, and all of those things, their height, weight measurements, all of those things. Those assessments would help identify certain disease risk or areas of concern. And the employee would be encouraged to take those findings or share that report with their doctor and work directly with their doctor. We'd like to do this through Alamance Regional so that they can be the keepers of that information, and that information, it would not be information that Alamance County owns. It would be something that's done between the employee and between Alamance Regional. Then the employee gets the screening, and they're encouraged to go to a primary care physician to discuss those findings. The cost of those assessments are going to be around $25,000. It's around $25 per employee. In addition to the health risk assessments, there's also a proposal to establish an Alamance County Employees Health Care Center. And basically, this would be a center that would be on the hospital grounds, not in the hospital, but at the Grand Oaks building, and it would be staffed with a physician for 25 hours a week, and then there would be a support staff there that would be 40 hours a week. The plan would be that employees could go to this physician assistant or this PA, and their visit would be free. any lab tests that can be done inside that center would be done for free as well. But if there are extended tests or extensive tests that have to be sent out to an outside lab, then the employee would, it would be filed with the medical insurance, and if they've met their deductible, they would only pay their copay. But if they haven't met their deductible, they'd be responsible for the cost of that lab work. The thought is that by only opening that up to Alamance County employees, their dependents who are on our health care plan, and then any retirees who are not Medicare eligible, we could get them in and out quickly, and it would limit the time that our employees are away from work. But also, if we give them that option that of having a place to go, maybe they would go for minor illnesses before they turn into chronic conditions. Right now, employees have a $300 deductible before the copays kick into place. So if you're an employee who just has something minor going on that's bugging you a little bit, but you haven't had any reason to go to the doctor yet, any reason to go to the doctor that year, then you probably haven't met that $300 deductible, and you may be hesitant to go to the doctor because you know that whole visit's going to be out of your pocket. So what we're trying to do is provide them a place where they'd be willing to go seek medical attention more quickly, and hopefully we'd catch things before they become big conditions and they end up in the emergency room. So that's really what the goal of this is. I when we talk about it in the insurance committee, we talked about it more of, it's kind of an urgent care center. It's not an opportunity. We're not wanting them to replace their primary care physician with this doctor, but it's a place for them to go and get these little things checked out that they may be hesitant to make an appointment for, and also limit the amount of time that they're away from work. There are some costs in here that I've put. The first year costs are going to include some setup and construction fees, and the first year costs are going to be between $176,000 and $190,000. After the first year, the cost should be in the range of $157,000 to $172,000. If we look at the 08-09 insurance plan year, almost $1.3 million was spent on primary care visits, urgent care visits, and emergency room visits that didn't result in a hospital stay. So if you look at those and you say, well, if we could divert 15% of those, of that cost from those different facilities into this health care center, then it should pay for itself. So we're really not asking for additional funds. We really feel like where employees were going to urgent care or even the emergency room for some things, that they divert and go to this center instead. We did do a survey of employees, and that survey, 92% of employees said yes, they would use this center for those types of services. So we feel like even if we just said 15%, we feel like that's a really conservative estimate. And the hope is that, you know, it would definitely pay for itself and maybe even save us money in the long run. At this time, we're just informing the commissioners of the things that we've been working on, what the proposal is. We're not asking for any formal action at this time, but just wanted to let you know what we're looking at and that we're going to continue to talk with Alamance Regional. We still have questions, and we'd like to work toward a contract, which we would like to bring back to the board sometime in December.
I think that's a great idea. And, it, you know, you catch those diseases that people put off, like coughing. I think that's a great idea.
What have you talked about the time of operations? Because
what we were
most
looking at
is sitting at the emergency room at
exactly,
night.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What we were looking at was it would be 25 hours a week, so that's what, 5 hours a day.
Right.
And we think that we would open it maybe 3 mornings a week, 2 afternoons in a week. And that way we could, for shift people, right, we could catch them coming in on or off shift and those during the day. What the thought is that they could call in, they'd get in that same day, and because we limit the amount of people that are going to it, they should be able, if you've got a 2 o'clock appointment, hopefully you'd get in there and be able to see the PA at 2 o'clock.
How many county employees do we have?
We're around I think if you look at FTE, it's like 945, but you have to remember that there are part-time employees in there, and then we've got retirees that are on the health insurance plan as well. I think, Steve, do you know how many covered bodies, lives? 1,400 covered lives. That's going to also include their dependents as well that are on the insurance plan.
Okay. Sherry, I may have asked this question before, so maybe I can ask it again.
Okay.
Go ahead. I was going to say something. It took me about 10 seconds to get my mouth open.
Snooze, you lose. Okay.
I'll be here when you get through.
Sure. The $149,000 a year on this fixed cost for a center, do we not have county buildings that we could use? That would mean that wherever the center could be would be closer to where we work.
We,
and not go across the county.
I'm not sure
and
that we've
save that money.
Yeah, I'm not sure that we've looked to see if there were county buildings. Our thoughts were that if we located it over near the hospital, that people would feel that that's more confidential for them. They would feel, I think we feel like they'd get a bigger sense of they're actually going to a physician if we located it near or on Alamance Regional's campus. We didn't look to see, we really haven't looked at is there building space, and we can look at that, but the thought was we wanted them to feel that this was not a county-owned thing, that they were going to see a physician that was not an employee of the county, because we want them to feel that their health care information is private information.
Commissioner on her, on the committee.
I am. You are.
And I've got Lisa Pennington is here from Alamance Regional. Jamie Athus is here from Alamance Regional. And Steve Cole, our broker, is here as well.
If I could just pick up on the comments you were making about the location and the $149,000, only $15,000 of that has anything at all to do with construction. And we are not charging the county any rent at all for the space. So all of the, except for that first time $15,000 to upfit some space to give the county employees a private place to go that we won't be treating any other patients, all of the rest of that is related to personnel, laboratory costs, and all those kind of things. So I just want to make that clear to you all that it's, I certainly appreciate talking about location or buildings, and you know, our space is tight, so honestly, we'd be really happy to not give you the space if you don't want it, but we are.
No, I was just asking, you know, because, you know, I'm looking at almost $150,000.
Exactly, so I thought it might
be
helpful
to, hear
that it's about $15,000 for construction to upfit an existing clinic to give some private space for that would only be dedicated to the county employees. The remainder of that are the personnel costs. So what I'm saying is that same amount of money you'd spend even if we came over here and did it in a closer building. So that's just a matter of where you all decide it would be best for the employees.
Well, that doctor could still go where he goes more than 25 hours a day as well, because he's probably over at Alamance Regional anyway.
Well, these are our physician assistants who are employed by our occupational health department already.
Okay.
And they're already working out of the same facility, different hours. For other contracts that we have.
Okay.
But I'd be happy to answer any other questions or supplement anything you might say.
Mr. Sutton, you have?
Yes, I don't know that much about it, I'll be first to admit it, but I do sense a worthy concern of this young person here with the clinic situation, and I don't quite understand, are we saying the clinics aren't even, they wouldn't be able to go to a clinic or?
No, okay. This center is not to take the place of the relationship that employees have with their primary care physician. It's basically a place to allow them. There are a lot of employees that we have that don't have a primary care physician. And so we're trying to find a place for them to go where employees who say, I'm not going to go to the doctor because I haven't met my deductible and I don't want to spend $75 on an office visit. We're trying to encourage them to go to the doctor, get that medical care early enough.
Instead of going to the emergency room.
Exactly.
If they don't have a primary doctor, they're going to go to the emergency.
That's right.
But we're limiting where they can go, though.
No, we're not saying they have to go there. We're not by any means saying that they have to go there. We're offering a place for them to go. And what we would do is we would commit to this for a year, and we would monitor the use. And if we the end of the year feel like it wasn't used enough, then we wouldn't keep going with it. But the results from the employee survey says employees are going to use it, but we're not by any means saying you have to go here first. We're just offering that.
No, honestly, I'm not sure what your concern was, and I'd like to know more about it. I mean,
well, if I can
read into it, I'm just trying to get some answers.
If I can address that, I think that what Dr. Wilkinson is proposing is based on the preventative care. Right. And I think that, you know, we're doing some things with that, but I think this is completely different because this is looking at providing employees prompt medical care, making sure that they get it. And the health risk assessment is the first phase of, well, how do we help employees identify what their risk factors are? And then once we identify those, then we help them get the preventative care that they need. So I think the health risk assessments, you need to do that. The wellness, the health clinic, you need to do that. And then you look at things like what Dr. Wilkinson's proposing, where you go in and put programs together to address these risk factors that have been identified. I mean, we've already got, you know, we've got a diabetes management program in place, and we have a lot of people that are diabetics that aren't taking advantage of that. So I think it's, you've got to continue to help employees see what their risk factors are, and there has to be some will or cooperation on the employee's part as well. But I feel what she's looking at is more of the preventative care, and I agree that that is a factor in it. We're looking at the wellness side at this point and just diverting some of those dollars from emergency room, urgent care, and other physicians into this one physician and letting the center pay for it.
What type of clinic do you have?
I'm a chiropractor. And what I do as a chiropractor has got nothing to do with what I'm talking about here. And a lot of the time we get a little mixed up in our terms, prevention, wellness, you know, nobody understands what all those things mean. And to me, this clinic is, it's a piece of the pie. There is a large problem here. It is one small bit of, and it's commendable, having a place for these people to go. To be able to utilize, because yes, your emergency rooms do cost more money. Problem is that is not the only answer. And a lot of the time, there are a lot of things that are going to be problematic with just that scenario alone that I won't get into, and I'll be sure if the insurance committee would like me to go over those, I'm happy to meet with that. But there's a lot of things that you really got to be careful of, because if you're just constantly trying to treat the sickness, you're never getting to the cause of the problem. And wellness programs, yes, are a part of developing something to get these people to take better care of themselves. The reason why there is not a lot of participation in these programs is because nobody's forced to get off their hind end and do something about it, right? That's the problem. And that is not Alamance County, that is national wide. So there are ways to increase your participation rates. And wellness programs, of course, yes, health risk assessments are a good idea. There are a variety of different kinds of health risk assessments that can be done, from relatively minor, if all that's being done are lipid panels and blood glucose, and you know, there's questions. There can be 4 pages, 15 pages, 20 pages. There's so many different things that can be done. The more detailed you are, the more beneficial it's going to be to help you find out what your population is suffering from. And statistically, as I gave you earlier, they're probably not much different than anybody else. And then the key part of that is, how do we intervene so that this person that has those four chronic illnesses and those coronary artery disease and the strokes and the high blood pressure and everything else, how do we force this person to do something about their health? That is the problem with what we deal with, is people are expecting the employers to be accountable for their laziness. Is that,
well,
not
I think
politically
probably
correct?
What we need to do is just you meet with them, and instead of, yeah,
I would be
more
than
yeah,
happy.
If you want to meet with them, then just get in contact with them, and because at this point where we are now, we're just talking about you guys going back to the hospital and working up another and talking with them. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what we need to do. If you would like to be included, then you can.
Does the Duke Medical Center have something similar to what you're?
Everybody has a different variety of what they consider a wellness program. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of different things out there, and Duke has been really well known for, you know, for their programs with the obese people, with the rice diet and some of the other programs. There are so many different facets of it that there is no catch-all for everybody. That's why getting those health risk assessments are key in finding out what do the county employees need. 25%, is that correct, of your employees are retired? Is that about right? Approximately?
On the health insurance.
On the health insurance plan. Yeah. So of that, you now have a different population right there. Because as I made those statistics earlier, you're 47% of the country that's chronically ill. Now, your retirees, as they start to approach 55, 60, 65, 76% of them are chronically ill. So the conditions you deal with are a lot different.
Back. Yeah, we need to get back to this. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks for your input.
But y'all will be dialoguing, right? Mm-hmm. Sure. Further? Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anybody got any more questions for Sherry?
I guess you need direction, though. Is that not correct to proceed with this?
I mean, what I want to do.
That's just information.
Okay.
Just give you guys the information.
Okay. We were kind of looking for consensus if there were major roadblocks that you saw.
I think it's a great idea, personally. I think that's what we need to be doing.
I would say, personally, I think it's a good idea, and I'd like to see you pursue it.
The only way you can do anything about your health is know what you need to do. And so many people don't know.
But that's what we wanted to do tonight. Those major roadblocks, and you had major concerns about the cost and the direction that we were going. We needed to know up front before we started doing the final agreement with Alamance Regional. So I guess what we're hearing from this point is we will begin that process and hopefully have an agreement ready for you at our December meeting.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Sherry.
Thank you.
Okay, next is finance matters. This one is budget amendments for health. Ms. Bass, are you ready?
Thank you, Madam Chair and Commissioners. As you all see, we have several budget amendments before you tonight. Basically, what you have is the fact that with the genesis of the federal fiscal year coming as of October the 1st, is why you seem to have so many at one time. As you all also know, that the state didn't pass their budget until a little bit later, so we have some state funds that came later on. And we still have some unresolved issues regarding some of our Medicaid funded programs, which will impact on what you have before you also. But basically, I can go through them one by one, or if you have questions about any particular ones as you go through. We have immunizations money that we've got, the $7,000, which we will be using to buy immunization supplies and things that would go along with providing immunizations, such as sharps containers, needles, syringes, and those kinds of alcohol preps and things that would go with immunizations. On that $7,000, the next item that you have is the Summer Food Services Program, and this is reimbursement that our environmental health staff are receiving for summer inspections that they do with summer camps and food nutrition programs over the summer. We get reimbursed, as you all see, at the rate of $126.77 per facility. And we had 38 inspections, so we received a total of $4,817. And this will actually go back towards paying for the salaries of the persons who performed those inspections. And I want to commend our staff. I went back and looked at some of the numbers, and we did better than a whole lot more than some of the larger counties. So I'm really proud, as we all should be, for our environmental health staff and the work that they do. The next amendment, number 45, is for TANF money, which basically those funds and temporary assistance to these families, particularly how that relates back to public health, is we use those for prevention of out-of-wedlock pregnancy. We will be buying contraceptive supplies with those, such as oral contraceptives, contraceptive patches, Depo, Provera, IUDs, intrauterine devices. And to some extent, we do have some funds that are left over that we can pay towards sterilization procedures if funds are available. And that was for the $14,624. The aid to county money was something that was initiated by the General Assembly beginning last year, and these are funds that come to Alamance County for provision of public health services. We normally had not received a lot of money. The state appropriated roughly $5 million across all the counties in the state, and this goes to help offset some of our operational costs. And we do have to, when we do our reporting, report back to how these impact on public health services and the essential services that we do provide. And as I was telling Commissioner Boswell before the meeting, is that we may have to use some of those funds instead of operations to go towards salary and fringe. We still haven't gotten our total guidance from our state budget regarding our wraparound services, which is our Medicaid case management. Those rates, if they were set at the rate that has been announced, so we would have some funding shortfalls, and these monies would go towards sustaining those operations. Next item, a big ticket item that just recently came down related to, these are federal dollars that came down for pan flu response. That was a $301,000. And those are set aside primarily to do large mass public clinics. Of course, the issue that we have as of today is we don't have the vaccine to do mass clinics. We certainly hope that over the next month or so that we are going to have sufficient vaccine to be able to do that and the resources it would take. We've been, as you all hopefully are aware, we've been doing some small, very targeted clinics towards very specific populations, primarily children at this point. But we want to start opening up to pregnant ladies and prenatal and moms that have just delivered within the first 8 weeks to get them immunized, because it's a very high risk group, and other chronic disease folks. So hopefully we're going to get sufficient vaccine to do that. But still, over the course of the next few months, to do the very large full-scale operations to get the general public and folks like ourselves vaccinated who aren't in the target groups at this point. So that's what those funds are for. So those are all the items number 43 through 48.
Can I ask a question on this, on the flu, whether it's the H1N1 or the regular flu?
This will be H1N1, yes, ma'am.
Do they have some kind of guess as to when that will be coming in? I know it does take time.
Well, according to the information we're getting from CDC, the vaccine manufacturing process, it depends on eggs.
And
this particular strain of the vaccine is growing much slower than they had anticipated. We had a good result again with the flu mist, which is what we've already gotten out, and that's a product that we've had so far the most available. But it's strictly a manufacturing problem at this point. It's just we're just not getting the vaccine out as quickly because it's just not being made available as fast as we'd like for it to be.
How many cases do we have? Do you know?
Oh, we don't do cases anymore. Just total report of influenza-like disease, and I don't have the numbers on that.
That's okay.
We'll give you some.
I didn't think you were getting. You don't have to do that now.
No, man. We just the only thing that's reported is if there are hospitalizations, and again, the state's doing that in those aggregate numbers.
I had one question on 48 there, Barry, where it says back where CDC encourages awardees to work with the private sector, and it says that they should try to build the insurance for the cost of the vaccine. Well, how do they do that? I mean,
can set a rate. For example, anecdotally, I've heard that some, you know, like if your local pharmacy. And I understand that some of our pharmacies may now have H1N1. They can charge a fee for providing that vaccine.
But say somebody gets a treatment, gets the vaccine that we provided, does that come back to you or the vaccine? Or how does that, accounting-wise, if the insurance pays for it?
Well, okay.
Am I missing the point?
If I'm understanding your question correctly, for example, the feds through the state have allocated vaccines to private like pharmacies, so they can charge for theirs. At this point, we have not charged for any of our ours. We're doing ours as a public service, and I think that, you know, again, if you go back and look at this total amount of money that's available, what we're hoping to be able to do is we're building into each of our job descriptions the fact that we're doing part as H1N1 response, that we can claim that money back and use that to be reimbursed for the time, because we have a lot of our staff who have left working their regular clinic jobs or whatever in our department to do H1N1 activities. So what we're hoping to be able to do is to charge their time back against this money and get reimbursed to save you all money. You know, in essence, instead of, you know, if we're paid directly from the county dollars to use this money to help pay for that activity. So that's part of what we're hoping to do.
That's what I was trying to get to there.
So we're hoping that that would, because these federal dollars do have, as all federal money does, strings attached as to how we can spend it and how we can use it. And it has to go towards our preventive health aspect and vaccination services.
Any more questions? Okay. Thank you.
All right. Do you need me to go on the?
We need a motion. You want to do it too? You want to put them back together, or you want to?
I'm gonna make a motion that we group them all together and pass them.
Well, now I was gonna pull out WIC. I would like to talk about WIC. If you're, are you saying include the WIC people?
Why don't we do what he's already presented? Okay.
Well, he was asking should he include it. So.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. We can go ahead and approve 7A. Yeah. Your motion. Right. We approve 7A.
I'll make a motion.
Second, okay. All in favor? Okay. And now you can find that.
All right. And as you all know, we also received an additional $66,730 from the Women, Infants, and Children's Nutritional Program. As you all know, this is a supplemental nutrition program. And again, we got the guidance from this as a result of our participation rate. And so it went up from $13.75 per participant to $15. So that additional $125, $1.25 per participant, that's basically per participant per month. And we have over 4,000 participants on the program. So that's how we derived the $66,000. And so what we're asking to do is to bring on an additional two staff members. You need to go ahead and elaborate on that piece of it also. Okay. And in your packet, you also have information on how that was derived. And, you know, you all know the background information that it is a program. You have eligibility standards that for the family to qualify. They have to meet certain income criteria as well as family size. And other parts have a nutritional need. And that's part of the WIC program is that you also, every one of the participants is evaluated by our nutritionist for their particular needs, and the food package is designed to meet that particular participant's needs. So as you see in the information, our patient caseload has grown by 1,300 participants over the past 3 years. The WIC program puts almost $4 million in our local economy annually. And what kind of precipitated this is the fact that we had a recent audit. The audit showed that there were some deficiencies in how we were not meeting the standards for people receiving their services on a timely basis in terms of being eligible. And so we want to address that part. They were supposed to be seen within the first 10 days of eligibility. And because of that, we not having adequate staff and then having the wait times available, it was taking us 2 months to see those patients. And also what's happened recently is the Department of Agriculture has changed the food packages, looking more towards reducing obesity rates and lifestyle changes to where there are now more whole grains and fruits, vegetables, tofu and instant infant fruits and vegetables and meats and things that were not previously in it. But again, trying to develop healthy lifestyles and healthier food consumption. And so, and looking at our caseload needs, we felt it would appropriate to have us onboard a nutritionist who would do high-risk nutrition, looking at folks who may have these risk factors, as well as doing that person to being accessible to our local physicians to be able to go to their physician practices if they have patients who might need the nutritional services and make that nutritionist available to them. And also we wanted a management support person to be able to support our other staff members and the new the nutritionist position.
And this is federal funds?
Yes, ma'am, 100% federally funded.
No county funds?
No, sir. It's all federal funds, and it comes, again, as a result of our increased participation rate. And the most recent numbers, and I had our folks go back today, and just to give you an idea of what happened during the month of September in Alamance County was the fact that our patients redeemed almost $306,000 in food vouchers. So if you, you know, you figure it over the course of the year, gets us up towards that $4 million that we do in, locally. Additionally, we're already over 100% of our assigned patient caseload for this year. We had 4,501 patients, and our assigned caseload is 4,500. So we're already above what was assigned as of October the 1st.
That's a large caseload, too.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
You provided a chart, a pie chart, not long ago when we were discussing some issues here, and WIC was one of them. And if I'm not mistaken, weren't the largest number of caseloads in the Hispanic arena?
That was 38% of our total patient population was Hispanic.
38% of the WIC vouchers.
Of our total patient caseload.
Total load. Yes, and it's quite obvious what the issue is there to a large degree as far as how illegal immigration has caused that intolerance of illegal immigration, how that has allowed that percentage to get to the point, to that point. But you have a statement here in your letter that, forgive me, that I find to be somewhat stunning. It's on the other side of the back. I'm sure you have a letter. You say presently the WIC program generates 3.0. It's on the other side.
He's got it now.
Got it now. Says, presently the WIC program generates $3.7 million for Alamance County in the redemption of food vouchers and will continue to create a financial stimulus to the local economy as long as the caseload demands are able to be met. Forgive me, either my idea of successful government and frugal government is totally warped, or to say that it's a good thing to have more money being spent in these arenas versus less, that's a stimulus, it really shocks me. It really does. I mean, I think our goal as a government should be to keep those percentages as low as possible and to spend as little as possible, rather than to ballyhoo the success of higher percentages, more money being spent, and so forth and so on. I don't know what we can do at your department to lower those percentages, but to make politically correct any statement about illegal immigration or the fact of what we're doing in our departments when we're confronted with one, and so forth and so on, to dodge the bullets there is in my opinion just creates a bigger bureaucracy that we've all got to pay for as citizens. And I'd be darned if I could celebrate a higher percentage of WIC vouchers and more money is being spent in that arena. And
I agree with everything you said. We have done everything we can to get you people over there to do your jobs and to weed out the illegals. And I don't know why you can't do it. I'm really disappointed that you're not doing a better job of that.
He's got guidelines, though, I think.
No, they don't. I was on that board for 8 years, and it's not guidelines.
There's no guidelines.
You know, they've got stuff that they go by, but there's no legal reason that they do it. Am I right?
Well, we have certain program guidelines that tell us when people are eligible for the program and when they're not. Mm-hmm. So our staff has to go through and ensure that every patient that we have meets the criteria in order for them to be on the program. And we have people come monitor our program. So we've not been, that part of what we do is not shown to be out of compliance.
We've been through that before, too.
Well, can I ask you one more time? One more time, you know, last time you were here, I asked you, were there any instances over there at the health department of people coming through having one name on a file versus another name going back to their employer? And in all honesty, the answer you gave me was, it was very, in my opinion, vague. Can you look at me and tell me that no?
I'm not aware of any, no, sir.
Okay, you say you're not aware. Can you say with reassurance that it's not happening?
To the best of my knowledge, sir, it is not happening.
Okay. Does the people involved in under your supervision that handle these cases? Are you confident as a manager that they are saying, no, we don't do that anymore?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Unless there's something I'm totally oblivious to, I'm not aware of.
Okay. And you'll stay on top of that?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? Do I hear a motion that we accept the budget amendment?
I make a motion that we do not.
Well, I have one on the floor. We got to move over here. I'll second your motion, Ms. Vaughn.
Clarification, are those salaries permanently paid by the federal government, or are they going to come
as
back?
As long as the money is available, yes, sir. If the money goes away, then we'll reduce accordingly.
I have a motion and a second for Ms. Vaughn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay. It passes. Okay.
Now, Bob, you've got a good case of those who support illegal immigration, those who don't. Please have it in the paper like that, so we're not going
to. Well, I would like to make a statement. I don't support illegal immigration, and all of these people are not illegal. So you cannot say that all of the 1,300 people that we have are illegal immigrants that use the WIC program.
Most of them are.
I work in the health department, so I understand all this stuff. Anyway, let's go on to the county manager reports.
Just a couple of updates I want to mention to you. We talked wellness earlier. Our county wellness day is this Friday out at HSC, and would encourage you to come if you would like. I will have a lot of booths and a lot of different things to see how we are currently doing our wellness, and it'd be good for our employees to see you come out as well if you could. We did also want to publicly mention, we've had a lot of discussion about Pleasant Grove and insurance issues that we've had, that we felt like we did not get the full value for the fire that occurred out there. We've been working real closely with the association, and we have got that figure raised to about $300,000. So
right.
It's about a $70,000 increase over their original offer. So that will help us, you know, lessen any county expenditures that we'll have out of pocket when we finish the upgrades. Is it Graham Recreation, the wellness?
And what time is that?
What time?
10 to 2.
I'm sorry.
Graham Rec. Okay.
10 to 2.
10 to 2. Hey, Graham Rec.
It's over.
Yeah.
Of college. Okay.
But we are, we've done a good job and come to a figure that we feel like is fair as far as an offer. Just an update also, demolition should begin out at Pleasant Grove on those two wings on November 16th.
16th.
Yes, sir.
What's it going to cost to demolish it?
It was 38,000.
38,000.
That's what we approved at our last meeting.
How much again?
38,000.
And that's with the big guy.
Yes.
Yeah.
DH Griffin.
Yeah.
Okay. Just a couple of meeting reminders to make you aware. Please do not forget Wednesday and Thursday of this week, beginning at 12:30. We do have the tax administrator interviews. Our Orange County, Alamance County line meeting is next Monday at 7 p.m. at ACC in the main building, room 301 at 7 p.m. The public is invited to attend as well, so we did get the main auditorium so we could seat as many as we can.
How do you get, you go into the, I'm going to try to be there. I got a class I'm supposed to teach, so I'm going to try to cancel it. I made calls today. I'm not sure I'm going to be, but what do? Go around to the front door? Because I might be right on the minute.
I think it is the front door.
And go in the front door?
Parking spaces are marked back
to the left.
To the left.
That's
front door
the main entrance, right?
It's to the left there. Right. You go in that main,
not my best
right video. Next to the library. Okay.
And the last meeting is our joint Board of Commissioners meeting with the DSS Board. It's scheduled for November 19th at 8 a.m. And that one is at DSS, so not the Graham Rec building. So.
That's it. Say that again.
It's at 8:30. I knew. 8:30.
8:30.
Golly, Moses. A.m. in the morning at DSS on November 19th. And that's all I have.
The meeting room downstairs on the first floor. Is that right?
Okay. Anybody want to pull anything from the consent agenda?
Minutes we didn't get.
It's not, do I hear a motion? We accept the consent agenda. I have a motion.
I'll second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Commissioner comments?
Yeah. Sorry. I have. Everybody else has some. That was a comment made at our last meeting about the county crime rate. And it was mentioned that percentages were shown in one paper and not in the other paper. And one paper gave statistics and the other one did not. I want to just clarify that. It is in the Times News where the number was given, as well as in the writing part there were percentages mentioned. So the Times News did do both numbers and percentages. And I think, Bob, I don't know whether you caught that or not. I certainly caught it last time. And I do clip these articles and save them, and thank goodness for that. And it bothered me, but I didn't have that in front of me. So I just want to make that point that the Times News did publish that in that paper back in August the 13th. So I want to mention that, just to keep the record clear.
Any other comments from?
Yeah, I'd like to bring this up, seeing how I may not be there Monday night, but for the sake of the commissioners that haven't seen this, Saturday, and Bruce Walker might want to comment on this, Saturday morning in the Raleigh News and Observer, they had an article, it should be on the internet, or we can copy this, whatever. We can copy it. But the title is Wake and Franklin Settle on Boundary. And it's the first I had heard of it. This is Wake County, Raleigh, and Franklin, and it says, subtitle, Some End Up in Another County. And it goes on to talk about how this has been going on just like ours has. It's the identical situation as far as I can tell, and it said the last survey of the border was conducted in 1915 based on the original done in the 1700s. Now, here's what they concluded in Wake County. That's, not necessarily a shoddy precedent. Owners in both counties have for decades paid property taxes to the county where the majority of their land lay. Now those owners, now this is the new agreement, now those owners pay Franklin County taxes for the portion of their property that is in Franklin County and Wake County taxes for the land in Wake. The rightful county of the homes that sit directly on the line is determined by the location of the room where the head of the household sleeps. A unique principle. Can you comment on this, Bruce?
Well, real quick, I mean, when I gave you guys a review of other counties, when I checked with other counties, we caught that they were still working on the agreement, didn't have an update from Saturday, but we did put in those notes that initially, they had this huge plan of like portions in, portions out. They had a flow chart and everything else, and they worked on that for a number of years. And at the last minute, they've switched it to accepting what the state says, NCGS, USGS line for that area. It's more rural, but is being developed. And they also said that the school boards would probably be allowing the schools to be in play there. But I did get the email tonight. I'll double check on the research on that, but it seemed to be, when I talked to them before, they had a reversal. I'm not sure why they had a reversal, but they went with the NCGS line.
Right.
Wake and Franklin. But when I talked to them a couple months ago, that's what they were talking about. Obviously, they just had a breakthrough. We'll get more information right to you.
And I've asked the county manager to please get a copy of the resolutions from both counties. I mean, I like to see all this. And
what's the date on that?
And the date was Saturday, October the 31st, News Observer, under Triangle and State section, and titled Wake and Franklin Settle on Boundary.
Any comments?
I got to make one point of clarification. I thought we were voting on the WIC employees, not illegal immigration. Maybe I missed something in our conversation there. Because I understand what you're saying, Bill, but the problem is they are required by federal government to do
certain. They're not. They are not required by the federal government. That is not true. There's no law that says that. I sat on that board for 8 years, I know.
Well, all I'm saying, I didn't vote for illegal immigration. I just want to make a point of clarification.
Well, that's why I made my point.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
But it is a stunning figure to know that a
it is. I agree.
Population, it only makes up about 8% of the population in the county, is 38% of the total WIC take.
Right.
And to sit back and think that we don't...
You don't reward...
We sit back and get politically correct answers on this issue, I'm sorry, from social services and from the health department, and to sit back and to see somebody at the bureaucratic level tell me that we should be happy that it's that the dollars have gone up and that the percentages have gone up is stunning to me.
I mean, I agree with bankrupt. That.
I'm ashamed of that figure. We need to kick butt and get that figure down. That's what'll save us. These kind of stats and accolades for them is what's running this country. I'm sorry.
Any more announcements?
See what you done? We all friends up here. Don't y'all take this thing.
We are adjourned. Who's stepping outside though?
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.